I greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. What a season and what a God. Holy and righteous Father, I pray for an open heaven. Come from the four winds, O breath of God, and breathe through us, God. Breathe through us, God, with the breath of God. Bring revelation, God. Let us drink from the river of God. We want to drink from above today, God. And we say, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. Get away from us. Shields up against you, devil, in the name of Jesus. We decree the devil get away from us and don't return. In Jesus' name, amen. And I want to talk to you. I feel this is important. In James 3, verse 17, it says, the wisdom from above is pure, peaceable, gentle, reasonable, full of mercy, good fruits, unwavering, without hypocrisy. And the seed whose fruit is righteousness is sown in peace by those that make peace. Now, what this is telling us, the wisdom of God is gentle, it's got peace, it's full of righteousness, it's reasonable, full of mercy, good fruits, unwavering, not hypocrisy. And what are you sowing all around you? Are you sowing the fruit is righteousness sown in peace? So are you sowing peace around you? Or are you, you know, are you speaking about what the devil is doing? Because we need to look, we need to drink from that deep, deep spring. God, let this word go deep. Let it go on good soil. In Jesus' name, we need to drink from the rain of heaven, that river of God, and we need to sow peace. And it says, blessed are the peacemakers, Matthew 5:9, they are the sons of God. So I want to ask you, are we being peacemakers? What is God's desire for us? People say, what does God want for me? You know what he wants for you? We can go back to page one of our Bible. Verse 26, God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, over the cattle, over all the earth, over every creepy thing that creeps on the earth. So what does God want? God wants to make you into his image. This was the desire from the beginning. Let us make man in our image. And then in the next verse, he created man. And he gave him an assignment to work in the garden. And he blessed him. He said, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth, subdue it. Rule over everything on the earth. Rule over that plague, the wind, the hurricane. Rule. And so Adam and Eve would have looked like barons, a baron and a baroness over the land. But what happens? Okay, we know they get thrown out of the garden and all the world is corrupted. And so what does God say in Genesis 6? He said he was sorry that he had made man on the earth. Genesis 6:6. Sorry he had made, and he was grieved in his heart. Verse 11, Genesis 6, verse 11, the earth was corrupt in the sight of God. It was filled with violence. God looked on the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. All the flesh had corrupted their way upon the earth. And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh is before me. The earth is filled with violence because of them. Because of the people, the whole earth is filled with violence. So he said, I'm going to destroy the earth and the people. And so God, Noah finds favor in his sight. In Genesis chapter 9, God makes Noah another blessing, just like on the first page of Genesis. He says, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. And then he says, the fear and the terror of you will be on every beast of the earth, every bird in the sky, everything that creeps on the ground, fish of the sea, into your hands they're given. So what does he do? He makes him like a baron, gives him authority, gives him dominion. He sets a rainbow in the sky as a sign he'll never flood the earth again. Even though Satan has perverted the rainbow is God's sign of covenant with mankind. He'll never flood the earth again. So then we go through the Bible and the earth becomes more corrupt and more corrupt. The whole time God's trying to raise up a holy nation. We know that he brought Israel out of Egypt. He wanted a nation for himself. He wanted disciples made in his image. And so the earth becomes corrupt again, and God so loves the world. He sends his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, to come and be crucified on that bloody cross, beaten, whipped, marred, and bruised more than any man ever, shedding his blood, taking our sin debt on himself. What is God's desire? We know in Romans 8:29, it's still the same desire. God says in Romans 8:29, for those he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son. So what does God want? He wants us to be his disciple. He wants to make us look like the image of his Son, conforming us to the walk and talk and thoughts of his Son, making us into his image. This is still the desire of God, because what did God say in Christ? He's getting ready to leave the earth. So this is, and what does he say? He says in Matthew 28:18, all authority's been given to me on heaven and on the earth. And we know there's scriptures where he said, the authority's been given to me, I give it to you. And he says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all I commanded you, and I am with you to the end of the age. Wow, he says, make disciples. And we say, harvest, harvest, harvest. Now I want to talk to you today. How can you make a harvest? If you're a farmer, any farmer would understand this. He plants his seed. And, you know, really, as Americans, we want everything so quick. We want to go to a crusade, speak to 500, have them all raise their hand. Put a picture on Facebook. I was at a crusade with 500 today. Look at all this fruit. And a fruit to God is a disciple. And we're going to learn that it's not numbers. He said, make disciples. If you're a farmer and you want to harvest, 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 you got to plant a seed. You got to water the seed. You got to pull the weeds out. You got a lot of work to do before you can say it's harvest time. Because God said when it's harvest time for God, if the branches don't have any fruit, he's going to cut them off and throw them in the fire. You know, so we want to bear fruit for God. What is fruit? Be fruitful and multiply. It's making disciples. And I was on this, platform in Mexico a couple years ago, and the pastor reminded me of it. I got up on the platform and I began to speak, and there's a few thousand people there, and I begin to speak, and the word of the Lord come out of my mouth, if you haven't made a disciple, you bring him nothing. I felt like crawling off the stage. At that point, I realized, wow, if we haven't made him a disciple, we bring him nothing. Jesus said in John 8, verse 31, He said to the Jews that believed in him and were all praying for the harvest of Israel, harvest to Israel. Well, wait a minute. He said, first you got to plant the seed, then you got to water it. That you got to wait a while before the tree is full of fruit where we can say, come harvest, God. So Jesus said to the Jews, if you're truly my disciple, he said, you will know the truth and the truth will make you free. So God said, if you're truly my disciple, he said, you will continue in my word. You'll continue in the word, and the truth of the word will bring you into freedom. That's what God said to the Jews. And I want to talk to you now, if we go, there's a certain language that God speaks all through the Word of God. He speaks about a lamp, a light. He's speaking, you could say, in parables everywhere he walks. He's speaking mysteries. He's speaking in parables. And what does Mark, 4:13. What does Mark tell us? Jesus is preaching about the parable about the sower and the soils. And he says in Mark 4:13, if you don't understand this parable, how are you going to understand the parables? And I say to you today, if you don't understand the parable, how are you going to, of the seed and the sower, how are you going to understand the mysteries of God? In Matthew 13, God says in verse 10, the disciple says to him, why do you speak to them in parables? And Jesus answered and said, to you, it's been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. To them, it has not been granted. So being his disciple, he's going to reveal the revelation, the mysteries, the revelations of the kingdom. You're going to understand them. You're going to read the word and say, wow, I understand this. Because in Matthew 13, when he's talking about the four kinds of soil, and he's talking about as he sowed in verse 4, some seed fell beside the road and the birds came and ate it up. This is the word of God. So he's saying, listen to what he's saying. Others fell on rocky places. They did not have much soil. And immediately they sprang up, but they had no depth. Shallow, shallow, shallow. Because they had no depth. It says that when the sun had risen, they were scorched. They had no root and they withered and fell away. Then others fell on the thorns, and the thorns came up and choked them out. The thorns, we know the thorns and thistles under the curse God gave Adam. You're going to plow with thorns and thistles. That's anxieties, cares of the world, the love of money. All these things come and choke out the truth in the Word of God. Then he says, the others fell on good soil and yielded a crop. 100-fold, 6-fold, 60-fold, and 30. He who has an ear, let him hear. So what God is telling us, 25% of the people that are called become his disciple. The other 75, many are called, few are chosen. The others get choked in the world. They get full of anxiety. They get all caught up in the messes. They get caught up following Satan, and they don't go deep as his disciple, because the fruit for God is the disciple. He says in Matthew 13, verse 18, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom coming from above, and he does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches it away, while it was sown in his heart. And the one on whom the seed was sown beside the road. Okay, so the evil one snatches it away. They're beside the road. They're not on the pathway. They're not following the Lamb. They're sitting beside the road. They're in shallow ground. And the evil one just steals the word, steals the teaching. The one on whom the seed was sown in rocky places is the man that hears the word. He receives it with joy. Wow, what a great word. And yet he has no firm root. It's only temporary. As soon as affliction comes, as soon as any kind of tribulation comes, immediately he falls away. And the one on whom the seed was sown among the thorns, this is a man who hears the word, the worry of the world, the deceitfulness of wealth chokes the world, chokes the word, and it becomes unfruitful. So it's the worries and cares of the world, maybe scared of the disease, watching, conspiracies. The word of God said, don't watch or listen to the conspiracies. So it's just being so wrapped up in what Satan's doing and not drinking from the word of God, the river of God. Then the one on whom the seed was sown on good soil, Matthew 13:23, is the man who hears the word. He understands it. He has revelation of the mystery of God. He understands the mysteries. He's not, it's been granted to you to know the mysteries. He understands the word because he's drinking deep into the river. And he bears fruit and he brings forth 100-fold, 60, and 30. So this is, God says, what is the fruit? What is the fruit? We say fruit when someone says, well, it could be good deeds. Well, Jesus tells us what the fruit is. In John 15, he says in verse 2, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, it'll be more fruitful. And the pruning, I do say, sometimes that's like, wow, God, it feels painful, but it becomes fruitful. And God says in verse 4, abide in me and I in you. The branch cannot bear any fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. So neither can you unless you abide in me. So the Lord's saying, here you are, this big tree planted by the river of God, and you cannot bear any fruit unless you're abiding in what's coming from above. All good and perfect things come from above, all good and perfect gifts. You've got to drink, you've got to abide in the Spirit of God. And he says, I'm the vine, you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. And if you're abiding in him, what's his name? The word of God. You're abiding in the word of God. And he said, if anyone does not abide in me, he's thrown away as a branch, he dries up, they gather him up, cast them in the fire, and they're burned. If you abide in me, look what he says in 7, my word abides in you. My words abide in you. And you ask what you wish and it'll be done. But now this is the punchline of what the fruit looks like. My Father is glorified because you're abiding in him. You're drinking from the river. He's sharing the mysteries. The word is unlocking itself from above. He's unlocking the word, the mysteries to you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and prove to be my disciple. Prove to be his disciple. That is so beautiful, people. Now listen, we know right now, okay, we know there is storms coming. There's more storms coming. But what he says in Hebrews about you that are planted, 25%, 75% of the seeds end up in the fire. 25% drink deep and become his disciple. Become, abide in him and walk it out. Look what he says in Hebrews 11. He says in verse 26, his voice shook the earth, his voice. So what's going to shake the earth? His voice, the word of God. This is his voice. People say, I want to hear from God. Get in the word of God. This is his voice. And it says, but now he has promised, yet once more, I'm going to shake not only the earth, but I'm going to shake the heavens. And he said, this expression, yet once more, denotes the removing of those things which can be shaken. He's going to remove everything that can be shaken as of created things, so that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Can you be shaken when everything shakes, the heavens and the earth? Can you be shaken? It says, therefore, we receive a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Let us show gratitude, which we offer to God in an acceptable service with reverence and awe, with the fear of God. We say, wow, God, we're part of a kingdom that cannot be shaken. We're not going to be plucked up because we're the well-watered tree. We're drinking from the river of God. We're making disciples. One disciple. Make a disciple. Be fruitful and multiply. It's a sign that you're abiding in the word. It's a sign that you're understanding the mysteries of God. It's not just an altar call where we heard Satan comes and pulls the seed out. He brings in worries. He chokes the word. He's, you know, they don't have a chance unless you spend time and cultivate that seed. And you water that seed, and you pour the word in that seed, and pray over that seed, and pray with that seed. And pretty soon there's a harvest with fruit all over the trees. Otherwise, what has God got to harvest? It's just dried limbs. And it says here, and I want to close with this, Daniel chapter 12. It says, at that time, Michael, the great prince, who stands guard over the sons of your people will arise. And there will be a time of distress such as never occurred since the nation until that time. And at that time, your people, everyone who is found written in the book, will be rescued. Many of those that sleep in the dust of the ground will awake to everlasting life, others to disgrace and everlasting contempt. Those who have insight, those that are wise, will shine brightly like the brightness of heaven, those that are wise, and those who lead the many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. He's saying for those that make disciples, those that lead them to righteousness, they'll shine like the stars forever and ever, like the brightness of the expanse of heaven. This is good news, people. If you don't know Jesus Christ, today is your day. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Come into my heart. Forgive me, God. Take away my sin. Empower me with your spirit. Give me the breath of God that I'll have revelation, and make me your disciple, God, all the way to the finish line. I want to follow the Lamb wherever he goes. And that fast, you can be delivered out of darkness into the kingdom of heaven. He will take away your sins. You just say, Lord, take away my sins and break the curse of the thorns and thistles off my life. Behold, he makes all things new. It's never too late to get on the good pathway, and follow the Lamb to the finish line. Lord, let your word go forth all the way to the ends of the earth. In Jesus' name, amen.